Hey, and welcome to part two of How to Study in Germany for Free. And I do hope you caught part one of this two-part series. But just to do a quick recap with you, we spoke about the DAAD. We gave you top five reasons to study in Germany. We spoke about the university ranking system and where you can find all that information. We also discussed the German language requirements and gave you some of the popular course choices that people have been opting for lately. We also spoke about the master's program and the eligibility requirements of the same. Now, getting into part two, let me quickly give you a heads up of what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about the two types of PhD programs and the eligibility of the same, the undergraduate program, the Abitur required for that, and if you're from different boards like IGCSE or IB, how does that tie in? We also discuss costs and tuition fee and a range of scholarships available. In addition to that, we talk about application process, deadlines, the kind of tests required, the paperwork to be submitted, and visas. Yes, that's the big one. The student visa, the resident visa, the work visa, the EU blue card. We've got it all happening right here. So keep watching. Let's look at the PhD program now. Suppose somebody has done their post-graduation also from India and is purely applying for a research or a PhD program.
That is very much possible, provided you have 2 years of master's, which in India generally is a 2 years master's.
Right.
So if you have a 1 year master's from UK right. or Australia or something, then you have to get in touch with the course coordinator.
Okay.
Because sometimes they do not accept 1 year master's.
Okay.
There are two ways of doing a PhD in Germany. One is the structured manner and one is the individual way. In the structured manner is where there is already a research group or a graduate school who is offering you a course.
Okay.
And it is more or less like an admission procedure that you go through.
Okay. Okay.
Whereas in an individualized PhD, it is you have to search for
the mentor
right. or the guide. You
right.
see, you have to
right.
find out who is best suited for you. You have to get a consent, so to say, from the prospective guide to accept you,
right.
and then you go and do a PhD. So
okay.
both options are available.
Okay.
The programs that are available on structured PhD are available and listed on the International Programs web search engine.
Okay.
And there are, of course, we have other specific websites which are also dedicated to individual PhD, like, you know, Research in Germany or PhD in Germany or Research Explorer. So if you have further questions, of course, you can get in touch with me anytime and we can take it forward from there.
And now looking at the undergraduate program, which also some students are interested in applying. So what is the eligibility for that program?
For undergraduate program, the eligibility is a little tougher than the master's and PhD programs. Point number one, because a 12th standard from Indian boards
right.
is not accepted in Germany.
Oh, interesting.
Yes, because the Abitur in Germany is 13 years, whereas our boards are 12 years.
Okay.
So
okay.
you have to
bridge that one year.
Right. And there are various options of bridging that 1 year.
Okay.
First is that you can complete your first year of college in the relevant field from India.
Okay.
In a recognized college as a full-time student.
Okay.
Okay. okay? The second option, which is there for engineering students again, is that if you get a ranking in the IIT JEE Advanced.
Entrance examination. Okay.
And the third option is if you complete a foundation course in Germany, which is called the Studienkolleg.
Okay.
Okay. Now, a Studienkolleg is again a 1 year course. There are different Studienkollegs for different subject fields.
Okay.
Like engineering has got a different Studienkolleg, management has got a different Studienkolleg, and medicine has got a different Studienkolleg.
Okay. okay.
And there is an entrance exam to the foundation course. Then you do the foundation course for 1 year. And at the end of the foundation course, you take an exam called the Feststellungsprüfung or the assessment exam, which if you pass, you become eligible to apply to the university.
Okay, okay.
So that is the procedure for undergraduate.
Undergraduation.
If you are from IB or the IGCSE,
right.
then of course they have got their own rules and regulations. Because IB has got a vast area of subject choices
mm-hmm.
and Germany specifies those subject choices. So if you have any further questions regarding IGCSE or IB, I would request you to get in touch with me directly.
Now coming to the highlight of all of this, you mentioned that the studying in Germany costs a fraction of what it does when you do in any other country. So would you like to take us through what are the cost structures that students can expect when they go there?
Absolutely. Basically, as I said earlier, 95% of the courses are free of cost. So there is no tuition fee as such.
Okay.
Although there is a administration fee that is there for every course that you choose.
Okay.
And that ranges from 50 euros to 300 euros depending on the city that you are located in,
right,
and the services provided by the university.
And this is per annum?
Per semester.
Per semester.
Okay. Per semester.
Okay.
So this would basically be administrative costs for the library, for the sports, for cultural events, and you know, for the Studentenwerk, which is the student union.
Okay.
And it also includes a subsidized student ticket on the state transport.
Oh wow.
Again, students have a lot of subsidies that are available in terms of museums, at theaters, and galleries.
Right.
And all that. So obviously it brings down your costs
effectively.
Yes. And the third thing that you should look at the costs when you look at the cost is that the German government has mandated that every student must have at least 720 euros per month.
Okay.
As an expenditure. Taking into consideration everything, of course, the most important or the largest chunk goes into your rent and your
boarding
and lodging,
yes,
of course. Then food is approximately 100 to 120 euros.
Okay.
Where we are speaking of you cooking one meal.
Okay. Right.
Not eating out every day.
Every, yeah.
Yeah. Lunch would generally be at the mensa, which is the mess or which is the canteen of
right,
the university.
Right.
Cooking one meal in the evenings is generally a social get-together sort of
sure,
thing, you know, where you either share it with your hostel partners or you share it with your room partners if you're living in a shared apartment, which is called a Wohngemeinschaft. In this 720 euros, everything else also has been taken care of, like, you know, your clothing you will require for your books and, you know, learning material,
yes,
and all
yes,
that sort of thing. And also traveling, because you would be bang in middle of Europe with the Schengen visa.
Yeah.
So you would be traveling, of
yes,
course.
Yes.
So some part of traveling.
Yes.
The final cost does depend on the place that you are staying and on your personal lifestyle.
Okay.
So, for example, if you're living in Munich, which is one of the costliest cities,
mm-hmm,
your costs would also go up maybe to 800 or 900 euros also.
Right.
Whereas if you're staying in a smaller city like Emden or Aachen or something, it would be even 500 or 600 euros.
Right.
But the German government has mandated that you have to show 720 euros per month for 12 months.
Okay. Okay, fair enough. So since there is no tuition fee, I'm thinking, what is the scholarship then, you know, for?
The scholarships from the DAAD take care of your living expenses.
The 720?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And partly your traveling costs also.
To and fro from
yes,
your... So it's free as in totally free?
It can be completely free.
And what are the different kinds of scholarships, the numbers of scholarships that you offer?
Well, from the DAAD, we have a number of scholarships. We have about 20 scholarships for Indian students because
okay,
they are bifurcated according to region.
Right.
And they range from undergraduate level till full professorial levels.
Okay.
Apart from that, we have institutional level scholarships as well.
Mm-hmm.
So coming back from scholarships, we have a scholarship for undergraduate level, which is called the WISE scholarship, which
okay,
is a very, very popular scholarship.
Mm-hmm.
And this year we would be giving, I think, nearly 150 scholars this scholarship.
Amazing.
And this is for summer internship
mm-hmm,
for 3 months at a German university or a German non-university research institution,
okay,
like Max Planck or Fraunhofer or Leibniz. This is a very toughly fought scholarship. It is not open. It is not an open scholarship. It is limited by institutions. There are approximately 72 institutions listed under this scholarship. The scholarship is majorly meant for institutions of national importance. So all the IITs, NITs, and some state level engineering institutions do come. Engineering and science, as I said, the WISE, right. This is a working internship for science and engineering.
Okay. Okay.
And this, you have to have 8.5 CGPA to apply for this scholarship.
Okay, okay. And this is, but at an undergraduate
level. At an undergraduate level, where you are in your fifth or sixth semester.
Okay.
And if you are in an integrated program, then you are in fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth semester.
Okay.
Then we have another one, which is for German language, where you have to have B1 level of German language proficiency. And you can apply for a specific scholarship. All the scholarships are listed on our website, www.daaddelhi.org.
Okay.
Again, for masters, we have four, five scholarships, in fact.
Wow.
One is for educating professionals in sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
For that, you require graduation along with 2 years of work experience in the relevant field.
Right.
Again, this is not an open scholarship. It is listed, 40 programs are listed under this scholarship. And this is majorly sustainability-oriented scholarship. Then we have scholarship for law. We have scholarship for architects. We have scholarships for artists and filmmakers and musicians and all that. Plus, we have special scholarships for IITs and IIMs at the master's level.
Fantastic.
At the PhD level, open scholarships for any field, for structured or individual PhD. And this is for 3 years. And this, as I said, includes 1,000 euros per month.
As a stipend.
As a stipend.
Okay.
Plus to and fro your travel lump sum for your travel costs. And if you are married, then you also might get a spouse allowance.
So you can take your spouse
you
there.
You can take your spouse.
And perhaps a child there as well.
Perhaps a child as well if you are doing a PhD.
Wow. You know, I hope you're listening very carefully.
And every year the scholarship deadline is 1st to 15th of December.
Okay.
And there is a lag time of 1 year in the PhD scholarship, meaning that from application in October till starting your PhD in October next year,
right.
There is a lag time of 1 year.
Okay.
This also includes 4 to 6 months of German language training,
okay.
Partly in India and partly in Germany.
Okay. Okay, so we need to be a little proactive when
exactly,
it comes to...
Exactly. Then we have a sandwich PhD scholarship,
mm-hmm.
wherein you are already registered as a PhD scholar in India.
Okay.
And you can go to Germany for 1 year for your research work.
Okay, interesting.
In that case, you require 2 guides, one in India and one in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
And as part of the scholarship, your German guide can come to India for your viva.
Okay.
And your Indian guide can go to Germany. To, you know, see your progress and, you know, all that sort of thing.
It all sounds so exciting. I almost feel like doing the PhD myself.
Yes. And again, it's a well-fought-for scholarship. So it's not as if you apply and you get it.
Certainly. So Shubhita, with respect to application deadlines, when should a student start the application process to Germany?
I should say the research of the application
right.
process.
Right.
Okay. Should start a year in advance.
Okay.
So, you know, you go and look up the web search engine, the international programs web search engine, look up what are the courses are there, filter the courses that you are interested in, see what exams are required. As I said, TOEFL or IELTS would be required.
Yes.
You might require a GRE or a GATE,
right.
GMAT, is not pan-Germany. It is course specific.
Right.
So there could be 2 courses under one university and one of them might require a GRE.
Okay.
So it depends on the subject choice also and a little bit on the course specification also. There are 2 universities that do require a GATE, IIT GATE score, which
okay.
is the RWTH Aachen and the TU Munich.
Okay.
Or the TUM, which is called. So they require a GATE score. The deadlines for the winter semester, there are 2 intakes in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
One is the winter semester starting in September, October every year, and which is the major intake. And one is the summer intake, which starts March, April.
Okay.
And that is a smaller intake. So not all courses are available necessarily in the
in
summer
both.
Intake.
Right, right.
So if you're planning for the winter intake, which generally the students would, then the deadlines would start from February.
Okay.
So their paper should be ready 1 month before the first deadline.
Oh, okay.
Every course will have a different deadline.
Right.
So the deadlines will start from February and go right up till July also. Mm. So if the first deadline is on 15th of February, then their paper should be out by 15th of January.
Right, which is why you say at least a year. So before, if you're going in September, October,
Previous September, October, you should start with the research and everything. Yes, that is very important. Because also the latest course specifications get updated in August generally.
Okay. So Shibuda, talking about visas, a student, on a student visa, when he goes, he or she goes to Germany, can they work as well during the tenure of their program?
Yes, they can work, although as an international student, as a non-EU student, they can work for 120 full days or 240 half days. These can be part-time jobs, of course, part-time jobs, or they are also called HIVIs, which are called Wissenschaftliche Hilfskräfte. Or where, you know, they help the professor in his research, or, you know, they have teaching internships.
Yes.
In that case, you can work a little longer on campus.
Okay.
But if they are off-campus jobs and all that, then you are allowed to work for 120 full days or 240 half days, which is a lot,
right,
basically.
This is for the full tenure of the program, 120
year.
Or per annum?
Per year.
Per year.
Per
okay,
year.
That is a lot.
That is a lot.
Yeah.
Yes,
you probably may not be able to get that much free time between your intensive program.
Absolutely. Because the academic programs are rather rigorous in themselves.
Sure. And this could be paid work.
This could be paid work.
Right. Now, post completion of the program, does the student visa allow them to stay back for a little while and work, or do they need to reapply?
They can stay back for approximately 1.5 years to look for a job commensurate to their qualification.
Okay.
But they have to understand that they will not be a student anymore.
Right.
So that the student benefits they will not be able to avail of.
Yes.
Right. But they are allowed to stay back for 1.5 years.
Yeah, that's a big thing itself given the environment around the world.
Yes. Yes.
And talking about a residence permit, is that something which could be, they could look forward to getting a residence permit?
Absolutely,
as well?
Absolutely. If you have worked consecutively for 2 years and you fulfill the work and social security guidelines given at that particular point of time, you can apply for the EU blue card.
Okay. I see no reason why anyone who's watched this show till the end is not going to go back and do his research, his or her research, and start applying him. Thank you so much. You've laid out all of this so beautifully for us.
Thank you so much. As you, you know, the catchword is research.
Yes.
Nothing comes on a platter.
Of course.
And you have to do your research. And if you have any queries, you can always get in touch with me.
But thank you so much for sharing the information and offering to help anyone that wants further information
always,
as well.
Always, most welcome.
Hey, and thank you for watching this two-part episode on how to study in Germany for free. I feel like you could be really excited about this opportunity, because if I were you, I would be on a flight to Germany right now. But I'm glad you watched it and I hope it helps you. So do write in with your comments at the bottom. If you have any questions or you want to give us some ideas on what to shoot next, please put in everything at the bottom. If you want Shubhada to answer something to you from DAAD, please ask that question as well and she will answer that personally. And please press that little red button at the bottom and subscribe to the channel. And happy watching!